that's a fun way to get started this morning, isn't it? Nothing going to steal my joy, and I hope that's your prayer too. There's nothing going to steal your joy, no matter what happens. Whatever's thrown at you, whatever comes. Let's stand together and let's sing Jesus Messiah. But anyway, it's good to see you. If you're visiting with us this morning, we're glad you're here. We just would like to ask you if we could get a little information from you, if you would. There's a connection card and a pew in front of you. And at the end of the service, you can just place it in one of the boxes out in the hall. And we're just glad you chose to be here this morning. Glad you all are here and brought plenty of food and desserts and ready to have lunch afterwards. That's all that's on my mind this morning. But anyway, our ushers are going to come, and I'm going to ask you just to be seated when the ushers come for an offering. Jonathan, whatever his name is, he's looking for him too. And Zach are going to play for a little while, and then we'll get up and greet each other during that time. And I have to say this, and I'm sorry, I don't normally talk. But Zach kind of dropped a bomb on us this morning. Next Sunday, he says, going to be his last Sunday. We're going to try to get him to come back and forth. But Zach has gotten a real job, and he is going to be working in Florida. So we are all proud of Zach. And so you just tell him how much we appreciate him and all that he's done for as many years as he's been playing and been committed. And we're just going to miss him. But Tiffany, you're going to hang in there, right? So anyway, let's pray. Ushers, if you'll come forward, we're going to pray. And ushers are coming forward. The plates are back there. We'll get it. The plates are back there. So let's pray. Father, we just thank you so much for today, this chance that we have to come and worship you and to praise your name and to give glory to you. And Father, we just thank you for the spirit that you fill our room this morning. We just pray that you just continue that and just touch our hearts. And Father, we pray so we'll see Jesus today. Use this offering to advance your word around the world. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. I'll just be seated. They're going to play a little bit.
Oh, yeah. glory, because I asked for just 1 minute, and I promise it's just 1 minute. For me, that's almost impossible. But I just wanted to take a second and say something about small groups. Small groups that we started about 13 weeks ago, I guess it's been. And a lot of us are... My minute's up. But we're all really busy, and we've been doing a small group, and it doesn't matter. The one Renee and I've been doing, you know, there's been two or three girls, and that's been it. But the one Ashley had started to lead, not really one of the small groups to start with, and it became probably the biggest one that we've had, and it's the youth girls. And it's so important to invest in them, as I've worked with them. Now, the ones that I've worked with are in college, and we're still doing it with them. And it doesn't matter if there's two or if there's 12. I don't know how many we've had, up to 15 or 18 at times. But last night, they all spent the night at the house. And it was just a great time of fellowship. We all went, they met with Marcus. They enjoyed each other. But she has taken time to invest in them. If you think you're too busy, don't think you're too busy. She comes from Montgomery every day. Just invest in these girls. If you're not a part of it, if you have a child or a relative that would like to be a part of it, please join them the next time we sign up for small groups. I challenge you, you're not too busy. It's 1 hour, 2 hours a week. And the return is great, because all these girls that you see right up front here have benefited from this. Relationships from all different schools, all different walks of life. And it's really important that they have that bond with each other to carry on through their high school years and into their college years, and it will benefit them, I promise. So please encourage someone to go to one, to lead one, and just to be a part of one if you're not a leader of one. It's really important, and I just wanted to say that. And I thank Rick for letting us continue to do the small group for the youth. So thank you.
Let's do it again.
Darkness rise. Spring. right toward the end there. Him and Daniel were talking. I said, what are y'all talking about? He said, we're trying to work out a key change. I said, well, I can help you with that. He said, you change keys every time the note changes. What is all that about? Oh, man. Have you been blessed by the music this morning? Amen. God is so good. You know that we have almost witnessed a minor miracle this morning. The first one being that Kim Sasser really didn't take more than a minute on me. I mean, really. Just saying. When you said a minute, I'm like, okay, well, we're going into overtime today, boys. This is going to be that way. I'm so thankful. Hey, I just want to follow behind what Kim said. Listen, small groups are really, really important because they connect people together. It's hard to do that when you come in and you're just part of a group of people in a sanctuary, especially this kind of sanctuary or this group of people that are here, because we're here and we're there and we're going and we're coming, and you know, you just may not sit by the same people every Sunday. You know, so small groups are great, and I'm really proud of our young people because they, you know, life right now is where they are forming the things that they believe. They'll find out that it gets really complicated after that. So I'm thankful for Kim, and I appreciate the small group leaders, and we have several. And I think they would all probably say that they are part of a great small group. So some of them eat a lot. Some of them talk a lot. Some of them do that. So be part of that. Also, we're very thankful for Zach, wherever Zach went. Wherever he's at. I am so thankful that Zach's got a real job, because it won't be long. I'm going to need real Social Security. So I'm thankful for Zach. So that's the other minor miracle. We want all you people to grow up and graduate and get jobs, because all us old people, well, we're going to need your money. Okay? So anyway, we're thankful for that. Listen, today we celebrate as a family. And if you would, just look at part of the family around you and tell them that you love them this morning. Love you too. I love that. I'm going to join your group. I can help you out with your makeup issues. I can help you out with your fashion issues. I promise you I can help you out with your boy issues, because there ain't never been a good boy ever made. I can help you out with that. All right. Hey, if you would join me in Deuteronomy chapter 24. Tim has already set a terrible standard this morning. He said I was going to speak for 5 minutes and we're going to eat. Well, he just lied to you. That music man just lied to you. I'm only going to use 6 minutes of your time. All right? We'll see how that works out. I may be apologizing to Kim before this is over with. All right? Father God, we praise you. You are so holy, and we are so thankful. Father, we thank you that as we lift up praise and music and song, that it is so deserving. Lord, we are humbled in your presence. And every time, Lord, you allow me to look out at this family and know that whether times are good or difficult or fat or lean, that this is my family. And that we go through life together, not because we're perfect, but because we're your children. And so, Lord, I pray as we celebrate this very special time in the life of this family, where as a family we spend our day in worship and praise and fellowship, hopefully extended beyond normal, that we will get to know each other a little better. So, Father, I pray now, just help us to worship. In Jesus' name, amen. Deuteronomy chapter 24 is, verse 18 is a little snippet of a big conversation. Have you ever been in that place in your life where you thought you knew what you thought you knew, but somehow all of a sudden you didn't quite know what you thought you knew? And then maybe even a little bit of confusion, you stop to ask a friend, kind of give you some direction. And so this is kind of that big conversation, the nation of Israel with the Holy God. And so God's going to kind of remind them, as the Heavenly Father, he's going to remind them of a couple of things that I think we need to be reminded of today. Verse 18 says, "But you shall remember that you were a slave in Egypt, and the Lord your God redeemed you from there. I love that part of that verse, Miss Ferris, because it brings it back up close and personal, right? I mean, it is about you, and it's about me, and sometimes we need to be reminded that we used to be something other than what we are. I don't know about you, but I'm glad I'm not what I used to be. Somebody just say amen. I mean, I love our Wednesday night Bible class because you can get so very real. And see, the Wednesday night group, they'll love me no matter what I say. I don't know about some of y'all. Sunday morning group, I don't know about y'all. But I just want you to know something. There was a time in my life I had to decide which way I was going to go. That comes for all of us, doesn't it? And sometimes, even after we've been Christians a long time, we kind of forget maybe how we got there. So Deuteronomy chapter 24 reminds us that like the nation of Israel, we were all slaves until God redeemed us. Aren't you thankful for God's redemption? Oh, he is so good. You see, there was a time in our lives where we were unable to free ourselves from captivity. I just want you to know something. Even as a little boy, I realized one day that my sins were sufficient enough that I had to have a Savior. And I am so thankful for the preaching of a very faithful man by the name of Bernie Enzer, who put it in simple terms that I could get, that no matter that I was just a little fella, I needed a Redeemer. I needed a Savior. Because I could not break the shackles of my captivity called sin. We need to be reminded that without that freedom, we can't experience the joy that comes with that freedom. I like to say it this way. Within the bounds of God's Word, we're free to enjoy the freedom that we have. Anytime we get outside of the Word of God, we just find ourselves in another form of bondage. The nation of Israel had been free, but yet because of their disobedience, they just found another way to put themselves in slavery. Listen, we need to be reminded that when we stood silently on the auction block in the slave market, there was nothing we could do to help ourselves. You know, we come and we celebrate the Father this morning because he is the one who makes this family possible. And it was through his divine mercy and grace that we were redeemed. It was that one that was sent from the Father to purchase us, to redeem us. How many of you believe that God so loved the world that he sent us his Son? Anybody in this church believe that this morning? Listen, on your worst day, remind yourself this, that a holy God loved you enough to send his precious Son. I've had some rough days, how about you? Man, I've had some days I didn't know if there was going to be another day. But it didn't keep me, Amy, from enjoying the day I had. Because God loved me enough to redeem me through his precious Son. Though it was very costly, the blood of Jesus allows us to no longer be slaves, but free. Free to worship, no longer shackled by sin. You see, what we do when we sing is we worship. What we do when we break the word of life together is that we worship. When we sit and we endure the trials of life together, it's just another form of worship. We're free to experience that together. So as a family, we gather at the family table. Many have been at this table before. Some of them have gone home to be with the Lord now. If I were the age of this group of young ladies right here and young men, I would love to go back and just sit. At the table with the man who was most important to me in my spiritual life. And that was a little bitty fellow by the name of Shorty Leatherwood. He was my grandfather. And I would love to say thank you for being so faithful to make sure that I was in church. Because that's where I met Jesus. And it was because that little 5 foot tall fella that I can stand here today and tell you a lot of wonderful family have gone to be with the Lord, but they ain't lost, honey. They're exactly where they're supposed to be. And one day we will be there also. I want to say I find great hope when we come to the family table that this connects us as part of a larger, bigger, broader family. I could call so many names just this morning of those who have been so important to this church that are now singing in a heavenly choir, walking on heavenly streets. We come to the table, we see the things that are very familiar to us. We see the broken bread, and we know that it is the very thing that reminds us of the very broken body of Jesus as he poured out his life for our sins. He was broken to satisfy the perfect righteousness of the Father. It is the cup and the wine that reminds us that it took the precious blood of Jesus to not only cover our sins, but to wash us white as snow. You go back in the old Baptist hymnal, and I know some of you don't even know what that is anymore. It's probably in front of you in the pew. It's that book that you look at and go, what's this? But you'll find some songs in there. Me and Tim talk about them sometimes. It's all about the blood of Jesus. It is that redemptive, precious blood. We see the very presence of a holy God as we gather here in his presence with family. You know, there's about three different ways of looking at the Lord's Supper. One of them is the way a Catholic congregation would view it, is that the bread becomes the literal flesh, the wine becomes the literal blood. And then you have almost the extreme, which is more the Baptist version, where it's just a remembrance service. But can I share with you what I believe? I believe when we come to the table, we come as a family. And we are in the presence of a very holy God. It's not just to remember, but it's to be in his presence. And be reminded that it is the broken body and the shed blood of our Lord. We are to remember that it is the Father who makes this meal possible. It's his table. Can I remind you something, Christian? It is his table. It's not yours. It's for you, but it's his. He made it possible. It is his bread and his wine and his family and his kingdom. And I want you to make this part of your notes. It is all for his glory. Everything we do is for his glory. Everybody just say that with me. It is for whose glory? His glory. No matter whether we're singing or whether we're working or whether we're chatting in our small groups or eating chicken with our church family, everything we do for his glory. This is why we come to the table, to put us back on true north. This is what makes us who we are. We have been redeemed. We have been blood bought. And we are to share this every time we have opportunity. So as a family, we celebrate these blessings together. We celebrate his great faithfulness. Do you know that he is an unchangeable God in a very ever-changing world? I don't like change. Do you? I mean, I like change when it's about you, but I don't like change when it's about me. Matter of fact, I love change when you change, but you try to get me to change, we got a problem. The older I get, the less I like it. Everything about my Father is unchangeable. This is important. Write this down. Jeremiah 29, 11 through 13 says, his plans for us give us hope for the future. His plans. I look at these young people, and I know that we're coming up on graduation. We've got a bunch of graduates in this church. Let me tell you something. His plans are the only plans that ought to matter to you. You'll be happy if you follow his plans. Some of your plans won't amount to happiness at all. Some of them won't amount to anything at all. It's his plans. His plans give us hope for the future. And when we call on him, he hears our prayers. I love the prophet reminds them, Chris, that when we pray, he hears. Isn't that good news today, church? I mean, I am so thankful when we call out and when we seek him. Jeremiah said, we will find him. When we seek him with our heart, we'll find him. And guess what? We'll find him in our heart. Oh, it is the greatness of God, his faithfulness that we celebrate. We celebrate his love for us also. We have become his children. And the world does not know us or accept us because it did not know him or accept him. It took me a long time when I was a young adult to realize that my goal in life was not to fit in. My goal was to stand out. If you're a Christian today and you live a Christian life, you won't fit into anything much, but you will certainly stand out. And that's what we pray for you. And we've got wonderful, wonderful opportunities for you to stand out. We also celebrate his great sacrifice and his healing. Out of his great love, he sent us his son to redeem us. And by the very stripes laid on the back of Jesus and the nails that were driven through his hands and his feet, we have been healed from all of our sins. Have you been healed by the blood of Jesus today? I mean, do you know when you look in the mirror that you may be facing a trying day, but in the very back of your mind, you know that it's going to be okay because you are healed by his stripes. We celebrate his great comfort. I love the way Paul put it in 2 Corinthians chapter 1. He said, we serve and worship the Father of all mercy and comfort. Isn't that good to know? That when we have problems, that we have a God that understands us and that keeps us. God of all comfort. As we share in the abundance of Christ, part of that will always come suffering. It amazes me how people in our generation only want blessings, but they're not willing to endure some of the sufferings that are going to come because of their faith. If you live a Christian life, you will always have some degree of suffering because the world won't accept you. But I love also what Paul said, because we have been comforted by a holy God, we are able to comfort those around us. Have you ever needed somebody to comfort you before? Have you ever had one of those days where you just need somebody to put their arms around you and say, I love you? You're going to have a few of those days coming up as you go to basic training. And remember, there'll be a group of people praying for you. If I was, how old are you? If I was 23, I'd go with you. All right? I'd love to do it all again. Does that make me nuts or what? 1979 was a long time ago. And you're going to lay there on your bunk at night and you're going to think to yourself, what am I doing here? Just the people are praying for you. Some of you have never had the privilege of walking into a hospital room where someone has just left this world. And being able to take their hands and gather around the bed and praise God for the life that has been lived up. Sometimes I think we take for granted the blessings of being able to be an agent of comfort and involve ourselves in people's lives in such a way that we can extend the very love of God to people that need it the most at that moment. You see, when we come as a family to the table, we come with all those things. We come with our worship and our praise, but we also come with our prayers and our petitions. We come knowing that it may be today that we need to extend that comfort to someone else, but it may be tomorrow that we need to be comforted. We celebrate that as a family, and we celebrate the great victory that we have, knowing that God is for us, and if he is for us, who can possibly ever be against us? Do any of you people in this church believe that? If God is for us, who can be against us? I mean, listen, as a church, we ought to have the bold testimony that says this: God is for us, and we, because of Him, can stand against anything. We live in a weak culture, and part of the weak culture that we live in is because we don't really know who we really are. I am mighty because of my God. How about you? I don't get knocked down. I don't get rolled over. I will always get up, and I will always move forward. Right, Jack? Amen. Not because it's my own strength, but because I have a God who has promised me that wherever I am, there He will be also. He is mighty. I'm so proud of Jack and his recovery. Jack is a quiet man. Have y'all noticed that? Jack doesn't say much. He's so embarrassed right now. I'm glad he can't get to me. But it didn't take me long after being pastor here. I knew why Jack was so quiet. Because J.D. doesn't ever be quiet. We've got such a group of people. And we need to remind each other with the great strength we have. I mean, we've had so many victories in this church. We've been through a lot in this church. And it all comes to the table. It all comes to the table. You see, that's why it's such a privilege to be able to pray over each and every family. And we've been going through the book of 1 Corinthians on Wednesday night. You know, basically, where you understand my theology, what I believe, is when you hear me teach. And that's why this place right here is so special to me. It's not the tradition that I was raised in. I was raised in a tradition, and I don't want to offend anybody, because y'all know me, I would never offend anyone. We pass the little cups, and we pass the little, and there's nothing wrong with that. But it's really more about the table. About His table where we come. And we come with our victories, and we come with our defeats, and we come with our petitions, and we come with our praise, and we come as a family. That's why this is such a special time for me. Because no matter how dysfunctional we may be, we're still family. So we come to the table together. We put away the distractions of the world around us. Some of you right now are already thinking about next week. And I'm sorry. I'm so sorry that you don't have a quiet moment in your life that you can ponder the things that are so much bigger than whatever it is you're thinking about right now. Some of you have already zoned out because you're worried about this thing that's happening this week or the thing that's happening that week. Can I tell you something? Just let that all go for a few moments. It'll all be there when you get back to it. When I was young, I used to think I had to do everything right now. When I was about 12 or 13, I could see 16 coming. I didn't believe that the Lord would let the earth stay here that long. The preachers were talking about one day that the Lord's going to call the church home. I'm like, Lord, no, let me get my driver's license. Just let me get my driver's license. It was there. And then my prayer changed. Lord, let me get a girlfriend. Just let me get a girlfriend. And I just knew the Lord was going to call the church home before I could find one, Ferris. She was there just like I promised. Put away the distractions. Just be thankful for a moment. Free to not worry about what may be ahead. We also come to the table, we remember our freedom. I am free in Christ. And because Christ has made me free, I am free of what? Free indeed. by anything, but I have been made free. We come to the table and we remember our redemption and the one who redeemed us. It is all about Jesus. Amen. It is all about Jesus. We remember that we are his children and that he loves us. And this morning in particular, we celebrate the one who makes this meal possible. It is our Heavenly Father. As our deacons come, would you pray with me, please? Father God, I pray as your family, as we gather at this table, Lord, that we understand that this table was a very expensive feast indeed. Because it really is about the broken body of your precious Son. As he hung on the cross to take away the sins that I rightfully deserve to pay for myself. It was costly indeed because it was the royal blood that flowed from Calvary. That didn't just cover my sins as so many other sacrifices, but it washed me white as snow. So Lord, I pray as your family that we come to this table knowing who we are. We'll praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. As you come to the table, if you would, as families, friends, we dip into the cup. As soon as you have,